Good morning, everyone. In my today's podcast, I will be discussing with you all themes of the Ode to a Nightingale written by John Keats. The first theme is death, time, and impermanence. Ode to a Nightingale dwells on the idea that nothing can last. The speaker sits in a forest listening to the beautiful song of the nightingale. The speaker perceives immortality in the figure of the bird, a creature that the speaker believes is unplagued by human anxiety about the inevitable march of time towards death and whose song has echoed across the centuries. Eventually, though, even the nightingale flies away, leaving the speaker with a deep sense of loss and a seeming reassurance that everything inevitably fades. A good way to think of the poem then is as an elegy for things that haven't yet died. The speaker's ability to enjoy the world is dampened by the awareness that nothing will be around forever. Perhaps that is why the speaker is paradoxically too happy to hear the nightingale's song in the first stanza. This happiness is, in a sense, already over and thereby also feels excessive to the speaker. Later, the speaker focuses on how time relentlessly presses down on people, producing weariness and sickness and making people age. Youthful vigor and beauty fade as a slow march towards death takes over. Even beauty cannot keep her lustrous eyes or new love pine at them beyond tomorrow. In other words, beauty cannot stay beautiful and new love will also soon be gone. Even the natural world comes to represent the crushing progress of time to the speaker, as flowers fade fast and become covered as a mush of autumn leaves surrounded by buzzing flies. Considering all this, the speaker states that now more than ever seems it rich to die and no longer live with pain. The speaker thinks it might be easier or easeful to just do away with time and impermanence at the earliest opportunity via death. The speaker also weighs up the human situation against that of the nightingale, calling the latter immortal and imagining its song as being the same as the song heard in ancient and even biblical times. But this, of course, is an exaggeration. The bird is not really immortal, but just appears so because its song is so beautiful that it seems like a small victory over time and death. Briefly, and only temporarily distracting the speaker from all this anxiety and grief about the fleeting nature of all things. Ultimately, though even the nightingale offers no lasting comfort, the speaker repeatedly bids it adieu, goodbye, as it flies away, starkly confirming the speaker's anxiety that nothing good or beautiful can last forever. This disorientates the speaker, who wonders if this whole experience has been part of a vision or a dream. The poem's final question can be interpreted in a number of ways, but perhaps it perfectly embodies the speaker's feelings about death, time, and impermanence. Do I wake or sleep? That is, perhaps the speaker, even while alive, is already asleep, because the inevitability of death makes life itself into nothing more than a kind of waking dream. The next theme is intoxication, consciousness, and isolation. The speaker wants to escape all the pressures and suffering that come with being human, and at times muses that drink or drugs might offer a release. That is because the speaker feels that consciousness itself is a kind of burden, that merely to think is to be full of sorrow. The speaker thus wonders if intoxication by dulling the senses might help ease that sorrow. And though the speaker claims not to be envious of the happy nightingale, which does not seem troubled in the same way, the bird serves as a reminder that the speaker can't truly escape human awareness other than through death. The bird and the beauty of its song starts to represent freedom from the limiting, isolating confines of the anxious human mind. The poem both opens and ends with the speaker's drowsiness, suggesting that the speaker finds consciousness exhausting. In the poem's opening lines, the speaker describes feeling a drowsy numbness, as if the speaker is drunk or has ingested an opiate. Opiates are drugs derived from the poppy plant, including heroin, morphine, and of course, opium. The speaker compares this to sinking in the river Lethe, the river in Greek mythology that causes forgetfulness in those who drink its waters. In the second stanza, the speaker discusses a specific longing for alcohol. The speaker wants a draught of vintage or a beaker full of the warm south. This draws a link then between intoxication and comfort, the temporary relief from suffering. Drinking would dull the speaker's perceptions, leaving the world unseen. But the speaker does not really want to get drunk. Instead, the speaker is longing for purity and beauty, and it is this longing that underpins the speaker's focus on the nightingale's beautiful song. It is interesting that the speaker does not actually describe the nightingale's song at length. Instead, the poem focuses on the speaker's personal awareness and how that is affected by the beauty of the nightingale's singing. Even when trying to focus on something external, then the speaker's experience is always filtered through the speaker's own perception. Consciousness surrounds the speaker like the walls of a prison. Consciousness is thus not just exhausting but also isolating. Ultimately, the speaker casts aside intoxication as a means of escaping the suffering that comes with consciousness. The speaker rejects Bacchus and his pards, the Greek god of wine, and his beastly followers for the viewless wings of poesy. In other words, the speaker briefly thinks that poetry and the imagination will solve the problem of consciousness, even though the dull brain perplexes and retards. That is, conscious thought gets in the way of poetry. In the sixth stanza, the speaker also considers death as an alternative to intoxication. This would end the speaker's suffering, but as the speaker admits, would make the speaker a sod, a piece of earth, unable to perceive the beauty of the nightingale's song. Suddenly then, the poem briefly argues in favor of human consciousness, because it at least allows for the experience of beauty, whether in the natural world or in art. The speaker's anxiety about conscious thought does not find any comforting resolution. Though the poem considers what it means to have human awareness, the speaker admits that there are no easy answers. The temporary joy of the nightingale's song, which seemed to distract the speaker from these questions, is over soon enough. This returns the speaker back to the speaker's soul self, again suggesting that ultimately people are alone, confined within the limits of their own minds. And as if to underscore this irresolution, the poem ends on a question that strikes at its heart: is the speaker awake or asleep? Dreaming, of course, allows dreamers to escape the limits of their reality, which is why the speaker feels that the brief glimpses of freedom in the poem may have been illusory all along. The next theme is art, nature, and beauty. Ode to a Nightingale explores the relationship between two different types of beauty: the world of art created by humankind and the rich variety of life created by nature. The poem questions whether nature represented by the nightingale and its song represents a kind of beauty greater than anything that humans can make, a beauty that is somehow purer and more eternal. The speaker considers this question throughout the poem, but ultimately finds no simple answer. The speaker in Ode to a Nightingale is not detached from the poem itself. That is, the reader knows that the speaker is a poet and thereby wrapped up in trying to create beauty and art. The speaker weighs up the possible beauty of poetry standing in for all art against the overwhelming natural beauty of the nightingale's song. This opposition between two different types of beauty is outlined from the very beginning of the poem. In the first stanza, the speaker claims to delight in the nightingale's song. The speaker is literally too happy to hear the bird's call, its full-throated ease. Nature here is presented as engaging in a kind of creativity that is effortless and pure. The speaker does not envy the bird, but even mentioning envy suggests that there might be a reason to harbor some kind of resentment towards what the bird represents. That is, the speaker perceives the bird's song as a kind of eternal perfection, a beauty created by nature that humankind, for all its efforts and strife, struggles to match. In the fourth stanza, however, the speaker momentarily does feel that human art is a worthy partner of nature's beauty. The speaker will fly to the nightingale on the viewless wings of poesy. Perhaps the speaker wonders, poetry can become the speaker's own bird song, and the sheer beauty of the poem itself might support this view. But the speaker's contemplation of the nightingale deepens and undoes this brief moment of self-confidence. The speaker perceives the nightingale's song as immortal, imagining the bird's voice to have remained pretty much unchanged for millennia, even back to the biblical times of Ruth. Human art, on the other hand, is corrupted by interpersonal rivalry and competition, the hungry generations that treat people down, and it's worth noting that Keats was no stranger to the scorn and wrath of literary society. Soon enough, then, the speaker rejects fancy, the creative imagination, as a cheater. Fancy personified as a deceiving elf can never match the pure and simple beauty of the nightingale. That's why, as the nightingale flies away from the speaker, untroubled by any of the speaker's concerns, its song starts to sound plaintive. The melody becomes sad and mournful, no longer the happy song of stanza 1, because it reminds the speaker of their own limitations. And though human art can undoubtedly be beautiful, the poem seems to argue that art and nature exist in two distinct categories. So these were the three themes of the Ode to a Nightingale. I hope it makes you understand the ode in a better light. For any questions, observation or feedback, please mention in the comment section below. Thank you for your valuable time. Here's wishing you a great day ahead.